So this is one of the questions that I get asked a lot about how do I express my disagreement towards someone without hurting their feelings? For example, probably like a wife is not happy with whatever the husband does. How does she approach him to tell him that without hurting his feelings? Or the other way around, you know, a husband doesn't like what the wife does. How does he approach her so that it doesn't hurt her feelings? Or maybe friends, you know, how do you talk to each other to express your disagreement without hurting your friend or your family member or whatever it may be? So this idea of how do I disagree or how do I express disagreement or some form of tak puas hati to somebody without hurting their feelings is an interesting idea, but understand that that's not how people work. You know, we have to acknowledge that within each of us, there is an ego. Every one of us has an ego, some more than others. Men have their ego, women have their ego. So understand that the ego really doesn't like when somebody doesn't agree with it, regardless of the context, regardless of the context, whether I'm right or I'm wrong. My ego doesn't like it when you don't agree with me. That's the ego. Everybody has it, right? And it really doesn't matter who doesn't agree with me, the ego still feel it. The ego is quite childish, you could say. Now, understanding that, coming back to the question of how do I say it without hurting his feelings or her feelings, we now understand that it's quite a tricky thing to do it without hurting their feelings at all. Okay, which is why I always say, don't focus too much on not hurting their feelings. Instead, focus more on making sure you can minimize the damage. Because hurting their feelings, you can safely assume that whether you do it in the nicest way possible or in the worst way possible, their feelings are going to get hurt because of their ego. Understand this, because of their ego. The ego doesn't like it when you don't agree with it. The ego doesn't like it when you tago whenever the ego does something wrong. Okay? So you have to understand that. So putting aside this idea of not hurting the person, and now let's talk about how do I minimize the damage? Because now you have two choices. Either I don't say anything just so that the person doesn't get hurt at all, but then the effect of that is I'm gonna get hurt because I have this thing inside that I have to tell you, but I don't want to tell you because I don't want you to get hurt, which is understandable, right? I love my wife. I don't want her to get hurt. But then there are certain situations where hurting feelings is necessary. What do I mean? What I mean to say is, I'll give you a simple example, okay? Let's say I and my wife, okay? This is a hypothetical example. I'm not giving you a real example, you know, for privacy reasons, but this is a hypothetical made-up example. Let's say I do not agree with how my wife talked to my kids, for example. By the way, this is just a hypothetical fake example, not real. I don't agree with how my wife talked to my kids. So what do I do? Well, I could not say anything because I don't want her to get hurt, right? Because if I say anything, understanding that she has an ego, like I do, I have my own ego, she's gonna get hurt. The ego will get hurt. So I don't say anything. That's option number one. But not saying anything will make me feel more hurt because she's gonna keep doing it. Understand that she can't read my mind. So if I don't tell her, she's not gonna know, right? She's not gonna know. It's not her fault because I do not tell her that I don't agree with this, right? So if it goes on and on and on, my initial intention of, oh, I don't want her to get hurt, that's why I don't say anything, might backfire. Because as time went on, I'm going to build up this pain inside of me, seeing her treating our children like that. And then it could potentially turn from me getting hurt to me not liking her. Very possible. Because the thing about negative emotions is that if you keep it in, it will transform. Right? It transforms. It becomes worse over time with negative emotions. That's why I always say you can't keep negative emotions in. You have to talk it out. You have to express it. You have to discuss. You can't just tahan, tak apa, tak apa, tahan, tak apa. Selepas ni semuanya akan hilang. No, it won't disappear. It might disappear from your eyes, but it won't disappear from your heart. You will still keep that thing inside. So the only option now is to tell her, to actually sit down with her, have a heart-to-heart conversation about this, because this is something important to me, to both of us, and I can't let go, because if I can just let it go, I'll let it go lah. 99% of things, I'll just let it go because it's not worth it. Well, but when it comes to something significant, like, you know, taking care of our children, of course I can't let it go. It's something significant, so I have to tell her. And this is where I can't avoid hurting her feelings. I have to tell her that I do not agree with what you're doing. I believe it's wrong. Ooh, you can feel it. You can feel it, right? Right? Even though I'm doing it in the nicest way possible, I don't yell. I don't call her names. I don't demean her. I don't insult her. I'm just simply expressing what I feel and what I think, honestly, about what is the situation. And she's gonna get hurt. But because I do it in the nicest way possible, in the way that I believe is the best way to approach her, because I know her, I understand her, and this is key, you have to understand the person you're talking to. If you don't understand the person, then you're not going to know what's the best way to approach this person. And it's going to, again, backfire again. So I tried to find the right time, the right tone, the right mood, the right words to say to convey this message of I don't agree with what you're doing. But understand this, feelings will get hurt, but that's not the thing that will break your relationship. Feelings get hurt all the time. I'll give you one classic example. You and your siblings, right? Especially if you are super, super close. Especially if you are super, super close with each other. Tell me, you and your siblings have this tight-knit relationship. You never hurt each other's feelings? Never, ever? No, man. I can think of 1,000 examples of moments where I really hurt my brother's feelings, and not just feelings, but physically as well, because, you know, I have 5 brothers and we're like 6 of us in a house. So obviously the testosterone is too strong under one roof. But yeah, we hurt each other's feelings all the time, but that doesn't make us any less bonded. In fact, you know, weirdly enough, all those experiences kind of make us more closer to each other. Why? Because relationships are broken not because you fight. Relationships are broken because you don't know how to fight. You fight without any limits. You go all out to destroy the other person. You don't know how to fight properly in a relationship. But fighting properly means that, yeah, I'm going to hurt your feelings. I don't mean to because I love you. But then after that, we're going to make up. Okay? We're going to handle this conflict together. Okay? We're going to make peace with it afterwards. And that process actually makes the relationship stronger. It's only when you test the relationship will you know that the bond is real or not. if you never fight with your friends or your siblings or your spouse, they're never going to know. Is the bond real? Are we close? Are we tight? Are we strong or not? You have to kind of test the relationship. Not like deliberately cari pasal. Jangan cari pasal sahaja. I'm talking in those moments when you kind of have to face the conflict and not run away from it. That's when your relationship is tested. And understand the fighting is not the source of the brokenness in the relationship. It's not the fighting. Fighting is normal. It's when you don't know how to fight. You don't have the communication skill. You don't have the emotional regulation skill. You don't have the negotiation skill. You don't have the conflict management skill. If you're lacking in all those like essential social skills to be able to, you know, disagree properly, obviously, you're not going to be able to disagree properly. And that could escalate into something worse. So really, the point is, to the person who asked the question, how do I express myself without hurting the other person's feelings? The part where without hurting the other person's feelings, that part we already established is not possible. The person has an ego just like you, and the ego doesn't like it when you disagree with it. You know, some who have the maturity to grow above their ego, they may be able to handle it easily. You know, when you tegur dia, he may be able to absorb it easily because he or she has grown above the ego. And that takes a lot of effort and time to do that, to develop yourself to be able to achieve that level. But generally speaking, we have to understand that everybody has an ego. Even the best among us has an ego. And you can't avoid from hurting the ego's feelings because the ego is nafs. It only wants what's good for itself. It doesn't care about anything else. That's the nafs, right? So it's not about not hurting the other person's feelings. It is about when it is necessary to talk and to have a heated conversation about something, how do you minimize the damage? That's the question. How do you minimize the damage? And that requires you understanding the other person. It requires that you have adequate social skills like communication skill, emotional regulation skill, all those like skills that you should have by the time you are an adult. Those things are required if you want to really disagree properly. And this is something that our scholars in Islam have demonstrated throughout the many, many, many years. We have adab in disagreement, right? Khilaf, like khilaf, adab in khilaf. So even our scholars in Islam have shown us examples of how to disagree. And they disagree on many things, you know, heated arguments, they have it. But they have adab because they have the maturity to go above their ego. And that's something that we can take as an example for ourselves to practice in our own personal and professional lives. Okay, to continue our chill session, as always, I'm going to go to Instagram Q&A. So if you don't know, I do Instagram Q&A session in Instagram stories. If you want to join that, you can go to my Instagram page at AymanAzlan90. There you go. Boom! AymanAzlan90. So this is from Instagram. The questions from Instagram. First question. I want to continue my study in my master's, but I'm scared how to overcome negative surrounding. When it comes to fear of anything, the cliche answer to overcome the fear is to face your fear. And I know it might sound a bit, you know, stale at this point to listen to this very, very age-old advice about facing your fear. Face your fear. But actually, it is scientifically proven that the only way for you to overcome your fear is to face your fear. So no doubt, okay, this is what you should do if you want to overcome your fear. But the question now is, how do you face your fear? Obviously, you don't just go 100% all at once, right? You have to kind of gauge yourself and pace yourself, all right? So how afraid are you? And how much can you expose yourself to the fear that you feel, you know, that you can handle, gradual exposure to the fear, okay? And as you gradually expose yourself to the fear, you level up, okay? Let's say you expose your fear this much, just this much. So you keep on doing that until you feel comfortable. And then you go level up. Whoop! Now you expose your fear this much, okay? And until you feel comfortable, and then you level up. And up to a point where you can safely say that, yeah, I have overcome my fear. It takes time, takes effort, energy, patience, definitely. I'll give you one example to illustrate this idea. So let's say you have a fear of heights, okay? Takut tempat tinggi. You have fear of heights. Obviously, I'm not gonna ask you to immediately go sky jumping, right? On day one. That's not realistic. That's too much too soon. So I'm just gonna ask you, what's the minimum level of height that you don't feel comfortable with, but you can handle it? So you might say, okay, third story building. Okay. All right. So we're gonna go to a building and we're gonna go to level 3 and we're just gonna peek out of the window and see how you feel. So we go to level 3, you peek out, you feel afraid, but you stay in the fear. You don't run away. Don't run away. You stay in the fear and you overcome it. You stay in the fear until level 3 building, not a big deal. Then you level up. Let's go to level 7. And then you level up. Let's go to level 10. And then you level up. Let's go to the roof of the building. And then you level up again. Let's go bungee jumping. And then you level up again. Let's go skydiving. So that's the general idea of how you deal with fear. And this is scientifically proven. And if you feel like this is too overwhelming, you don't know where to start, then I suggest you go for counseling. All right. So counselors can help you dealing with this fear. So if you are a master's student, you can go to the counseling center in your university, ask for help to deal with the fear, and to find the source of the fear, why do you feel the fear, and to basically overcome the fear step by step. All the best. Make a webinar about ghosting, please. Should I? A webinar about ghosting? I did talk about ghosting in a couple of places. I think I made a video about ghosting. I'm not sure. Well, I did write a newsletter about ghosting and I answered many, many, many questions about ghosting. Should I make a webinar about it? I don't know. I don't know if there's enough information for me to justify me making a webinar about it, but I understand that it is a very serious issue that a lot of people are having right now. So I might consider it, okay? Macam mana cara untuk seorang perempuan menyatakan niat dia untuk kenal seorang lelaki untuk tujuan nikah? Macam mana cara dia? Sama ada directly approach dia atau hantar orang tengah? Cara terbaik adalah hantar orang tengah. Orang yang terbaik adalah wali anda sebagai orang tengah untuk bagi tahu lelaki itu, bukan bagi tahu perasaan. That's the wrong way to confess. Jangan confess perasaan. Jangan cakap, oh saya suka you lah. Sebab tidak ada call to action yang jelas. So orang tu jadi confused. You nak apa sebenarnya ni? Okay, you suka I and then what? You nak jadi girlfriend? You nak that? So it's better to jelaskan niat terus. So bagi tahu kat dia yang katakanlah wali anda pergi. So wali anda jumpa lelaki tu and dia kata anak saya, anak perempuan saya berminat nak consider awak sebagai suami dia. Sudi tak awak ta'aruf dengan dia? See? Simple. Jelaskan niat dan tanya soalan tu. Sudi atau tidak? Yes or no. Okay, jawapan dia yes or no je tau. Bukan jawapan dia, insyaAllah pakcik. No, penampar sebiji. Jangan bagi jawapan macam tu. Yes or no. Sebab apa? Sebab kalau kita bagi jawapan yang samar-samar, dia tak membantu tau. Dia just akan menyebabkan emosi jadi celaru. And banyak orang komplain benda ni dekat saya. Dia kata, saya tak pastilah dia nak apa. Memanglah you tak pasti sebab jawapan dia samar-samar. Okay, so if you want to give an answer, give a proper answer. Yes or no? Okay, if you need more time, tak apa. Cakap yang, Pakcik, saya perlukan masa untuk fikir. Bagi saya 2 minggu, saya akan bagi jawapan lepas tu. And you have to give a specific deadline. Berapa lama? Kalau nak tunggu, berapa lama? 2 minggu. Okay, 2 minggu set. Okay, 2 minggu. tak ganggu, bagi dia masa untuk berfikir, and then after 2 minggu, dia kena bagi tahu lah jawapan dia apa. Yes or no. So tu cara dia. More details boleh join saya punya siri kahwin yang berlaku sekarang pada bulan ini. Boleh pergi kepada aimanazlan.com/kahwin. Boom! Tu dia. Next. Dah approach guna orang tengah dan dia dah berpunya. Susah nak move on sebab masih bekerja dengan dia. Help. So dalam kes yang macam ni, moving on memang akan makan masa lah. Especially sebab anda dengan dia bekerja di tempat yang sama. So bersabarlah dengan proses tu. Tapi kalau anda sudah memahami istikharah, dah memahami apa maksud istikharah, dah memahami yang mungkin dia bukan untuk you dan apa maksud dia berdasarkan panduan istikharah tu, InsyaAllah itu akan, bukannya akan terus menyebabkan you move on, tapi dia akan membantu memudahkan sedikit proses nak move on tu. Tapi kena faham lah, ini satu proses moving on ni. Dia bukannya macam terus boom, move on. Especially sebab benda tu benda yang you ambil berat. You care about that. So obviously dia akan takes time lah untuk nak betul-betul heal and move on. But this is part of the process. You know, kita merasai rejection tu benda yang adalah salah satu elemen kehidupan yang kita tak boleh elak. Saya bagi satu benda yang mungkin tak ramai orang fikir. Dalam perkahwinan pun, sewaktu dah sah jadi suami isteri, anda still possible untuk experience rejection. Ya, sebagai contoh, anak saya ada ketika dia tak nakkan saya. Dia reject saya, dia tak nakkan saya, dia nakkan mak dia. So that's a form of rejection, right? So facing rejection in life is a normal thing. Dan kita perlu ada skill untuk menghadapi rejection tu. Dan kalau anda perlukan bantuan, saya recommend buku ni. Nama buku ni Emotional First Aid. Saya tulis by Dr. Guy Winch. Emotional First Aid by Dr. Guy Winch. May saya share screen supaya you nampak. Okay, there you go. Emotional First Aid, Dr. Guy Winch. Dia seorang psikologis yang menulis buku tentang everyday hurts. And among everyday hurts adalah rejection, you see? So it's a very normal thing that we experience in life. So memang nak tak nak memang kita akan merasailah benda tu. It's a very normal thing. Ni buku ni. Ni, the first one. Emotional First Aid. Nampak ke? Kau tak nampak? Sekejap kalau tak nampak, sekejap. Saya bagi yang lebih befau. Besar sikit. There you go. Boom. Ni besar sikit. Nampak kan? Alright. Okay. Other than that, you boleh juga join webinar saya dalam siri aimanazlan.com/kahwin ni. Siri kahwin ni. The next webinar akan berlaku hari Jumaat ni. Jumaat ni adalah webinar seterusnya dan webinar tersebut adalah berkenaan istikharah. Kan ramai orang dengar saya cakap pasal istikharah. Apa benda istikharah ni? So, kita akan bincang. Jumaat ni, kita bincang pasal istikharah in and out. Anda akan faham macam mana nak buat istikharah, istikharah tu apa dia, apakah itu doa istikharah dan apakah hikmah doa istikharah yang boleh membantu kita move on kalau kita kena reject ke, benda tak jadi ke, macam-macam lah boleh jadi dalam proses nak berkahwin tu kan. So, istikharah tu dia ada kunci untuk nak memahami cara nak move on. Bukan nak kata istikharah ni macam magic tiba-tiba boleh move on terus. No. Macam saya cakap lah, benda ni proses. Dia ambil masa. Tapi kalau kita faham hikmah di sebalik istikharah tu, dia akan boleh bantu kita memudahkan sedikit lah proses tu. Itu point dia. Okay? Itu point dia. Next. How to reba when someone reject us. Baru cakap. Join my webinar this Friday. Go to aimanazlan.com/kahwin. The topic of the webinar is literally menjadi redha. Kena dengan you punya soalan ni. Menjadi redha. And we will talk about istikharah to understand how to do that. Is it possible kalau bercinta tapi tak pernah jumpa? Is it possible? Depends on what you mean by cinta. Bagi saya itu bukan cinta. Bagi saya itu dipanggil infatuation. Infatuation ni apa dalam bahasa Melayu Itu perkataan bahasa Inggeris dia. Tapi saya tak pasti apa perkataan bahasa Melayu dia. Kejap, saya nak cuba cari. Infatuation definition. Macam mana nak translate bahasa Melayu Infatuation. Okay, infatuation is an intense but short-lived passion or admiration for someone or some. Oh, macam crush. Macam crush lah, lebih kurang infatuation ni. Lebih kurang macam crush. So, I think that's what you're feeling. And it's a valid emotion. I'm not saying that what you're feeling is not real. It is real, okay? But I wouldn't call it cinta. I wouldn't call it love lah. Per se. As a married man, I wouldn't call it love. Love requires some form of test or challenge when you see the person as he is or as she is, okay? No hiding, no like apa control macho, nothing. When you see the person in his or her truest form and you can still accept the person, that's love, okay? Itu baru love. But kalau you tak pernah jumpa dia, tak pernah berinteraksi dengan dia, tak pernah menghadapi cabaran hidup bersama, I don't think you can call it love, but you can call it crush, infatuation, rasa berkenan. That's normal sebelum kahwin. That's what you need sebelum kahwin. But untuk nak masuk ke gerbang perkahwinan, you need to meet each other. Bukan dalam dating, okay? Dalam ta'aruf. Okay, apa maksud saya? Okay, dia punya penjelasan panjang lah. Kalau nak penjelasan yang lengkap, again, boom. Pergi dekat imazlan.com/kahwin dan you refer balik webinar minggu lepas tentang ta'aruf. Nama webinar tu, mencari dia. So, antara elemen yang penting dalam webinar adalah, dalam ta'aruf adalah face-to-face interaction tu. Penting. Don't you ever like answer all this question make you have emotional baggage to people? Dia tanya saya. Saya jawab banyak sangat soalan ni, ada tak emotional baggage? No, because bukan maksud dia saya ni tak ada emosi. No, I have emotions. I do feel, right? But I learn, and this is like, you know, counseling skills that you learn in class. I'm a counseling student. InsyaAllah, one day I want to become a licensed marriage counselor. One day, make dua for me. I have my, you know, 10-year plan. But yeah, this is part of the counseling skill. If you are a counselor, you can back me up. So as a counselor, we have to learn how not to carry our clients' problems on our shoulders. And the best explanation that I have come across is an explanation by a clinical psychologist by the name of Dr. Jordan Peterson from Canada. And he explained it this way. If you carry other people's problems, it's like you doing other people's homework, all right? So a lot of my followers are students, you can relate to this. Or non-students pun boleh relate juga, you pernah kan jadi student? So bagus ke tak bagus kalau you buat kerja rumah orang lain? You tolong kawan, you quote-unquote tolong kawan buat kerja rumah dia. Maybe bagi you, you rasa macam, wah aku sedang menolong kawan. But really, if you look at the big picture, kalau kita buat kerja rumah orang lain, kita sebenarnya tak menolong dia. In the long run, secara long term, kita tak menolong dia. Kerana tujuan kerja rumah tu diberikan kepada dia adalah supaya dia belajar cara nak buat kerja rumah tu. Supaya dia boleh upgrade skill level dia, knowledge level dia untuk boleh buat kerja rumah tu. That's why kerja rumah tu dia kena buat, bukan you buat untuk dia. Kalau you buat untuk dia, memanglah dia seronoklah sebab kerja rumah dia siap. Tapi dia tidak dapat benefit daripada kerja rumah tu. So itu dah analogi yang saya pegang. Kenapa saya tak carry problem orang lain? Bukan sebab saya tak kisah. Okay, bukan sebab saya tak ada rasa empathy. Saya ada. I do feel empathy. But I also understand that ujian ni diberikan kepada dia untuk dia selesaikan. Saya punya role bukan untuk selesaikan masalah dia untuk dia. Itu bukan role saya. Itu ibarat saya buat kerja rumah dia. My role is I will help you so that you can help yourself. That's my role. So saya tak carry other people's problem. I don't carry people's problems. People's problems are for them to solve. But my role, I'm here to help. I'm here to listen. I'm here to help you figure things out. But I don't solve your problem for you. And that's why I can still do this every day and not be, you know, an emotional wreck. And I think it's a very crucial thing. It's very important lah, because I know how damaging it can be if you carry so many people's problems on your shoulders, obviously you can add this emotional baggage. You can't take it. You can't handle it. You're, as a human being, you're not designed for that. But to listen, to have empathy, yeah, you are definitely designed for that. Kalau dah rasa sekufu, tapi ada satu attitude yang tak digemari, adakah masih sekufu? Sekufu ni tak bermaksud semua kena perfect. Sekufu ni maksud dia, you dengan dia boleh ngam tak? Okay, contoh yang selalu saya bagi adalah you dengan you punya best friend. Adakah you suka semua benda pasal best friend you? No, ada benda dia buat saya tak suka. Tapi dia still saya punya best friend. Kami still ngam. Kami still sekufu. You see? So kahwin pun sama juga. You tak semestinya kena like perfect semua benda untuk sekufu. Persoalan dia adalah boleh ngam ke tak? So macam mana nak tahu boleh ngam ke tak? Sebab tu penting kena ada ta'aruf. Sebab you nak tahu kita ni boleh ngam ke tak bila kita berbincang, bila kita berdiskusi, kita ada argument ke apa ke. Boleh tak kita get along, you know, bila kita agree, bila kita disagree, kita punya personality macam mana. Sebab tu penting untuk ada ta'aruf yang face to face. Bukannya texting, sebab bila you kahwin nanti you nak texting all the time ke? No, you akan berdepan dengan dia. So penting untuk dapat tahu benda ni sebelum perkahwinan. Bukan dengan dating, tapi dengan sesi ta'aruf yang proper. Any tips untuk yang first time pergi raya di rumah bakal mertua? Rumah bakal mertua? So tak kahwin lagi? And you nak pergi beraya kat rumah bakal mertua? Any tips? Just be yourself. Jangan cuba nak berpura-pura jadi orang lain. Sebab you know, kok mana pun mertua you akan kenal you siapa tau. So yeah. Macam cara saya fikir macam ni. Macam saya ada experience juga. Like before kahwin dengan isteri saya tu, saya jumpa dengan bakal mertua saya pada waktu tu. And yeah, saya memang ada, memanglah tipulah nak kata tak ada rasa macam nak impress dia orang. Mestilah ada rasa nak impress dia orang. Tapi deep down saya juga tahu yang kalau saya over sangat berlakon sebab semata-mata nak impress dia orang, tak ada gunanya. Sebab nanti bila saya kahwin dengan anak dia orang, dia orang akan tahu saya macam mana. So it's better for me untuk show them who I am and for them to accept me for who I am. Sebab then tidak ada sebarang terkejut, oh Aiman macam ni rupanya. Tak. They know me. Before marriage, perangai saya macam tu. After marriage, perangai saya macam tu juga. Alright? So, it's best for them to accept me for who I am as opposed to accept me for who they think I am. Sebab kalau nak berlakon, berapa lama you boleh berlakon? Nak kahwin ni berpuluh-puluh tahun je tak? Penat je nak berlakon. Baik, you just be yourself. What should I do if people talk bad about us? You cannot control what people say, but you can control how you respond. So how do you interpret what they say? How do you respond to them? All within your control. But you cannot control what people say lah. People say bad stuff about you. People say good stuff about you. You cannot control that. You're going to have both likers and haters. That's generally accepted for all of us. Think of it this way. Even the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the best person among us, dia pun ada orang tak suka dia. Right? So it's not about like wanting everybody to like us. It's more about, are you living your life based on your principles? Like sound principles, right? Are you living by your truth? Are you living by some moral code? Or are you just pleasing others for the sake of pleasing others? Apa pandangan abang tentang orang yang mencari kesempurnaan? Orang yang mencari kesempurnaan adalah orang yang normal. Kita semua mencari kesempurnaan. Cumanya kita kena hati-hati. Kesempurnaan tidak wujud di dunia. Kesempurnaan wujud di akhirat. Saya ada satu apa quote daripada seorang ustaz ni, dia kata, "Tahu tak kenapa kita manusia suka kesempurnaan? Kerana kita datang daripada tempat yang sempurna dan kita nak kembali ke tempat yang sempurna. Sebab itulah dalam diri kita, ada fitrah dalam diri kita ni yang kita nakkan kesempurnaan. Cuma masalah dia adalah kita tersilap cari tempat. Kita cari kesempurnaan kat dunia. Padahal kesempurnaan yang kita cari tu tak ada kat sini. Dia ada kat sana." Oh, mind blown. But yeah, mencari kesempurnaan tu it's a normal thing. Memang semua manusia ada, cuma kita kena hati-hati. Jangan nak expect kesempurnaan di sini, di dunia. No, tak wujud kat sini. Kalau kita suka seseorang dan dia sudah hak orang, should we confess? Kalau dia hak orang, you kena move on lah. Obvious kan? Dia hak orang. Hak orang tu maksudnya apa? Maybe dia dah kahwin ataupun dia dah bertunang, so you tak boleh kacau. Unless dalam dalam you know, situasi poligami sebagai contohnya, adalah dia punya permissibility di situ, ada kebolehan di situ. But kalau nak sampai ke tahap poligami, make sure you buat betul-betul. Jangan main buat belakang-belakang tabir, jangan main buat apa belakang pengetahuan isteri pertama, jangan buat kahwin kat Thailand, jangan buat benda macam tu. Tolonglah, tolonglah. Kalau nak kalau nak poligami, do it properly. Okay, do it properly. If I have a partner that have trauma or mental health problem and bad past life, how to manage it? Well, your partner need help. Your partner need to meet with a professional to be able to deal with the trauma and move on. Okay, so go get help. Go get help from a counselor, psychiatrist, psychologist. Hopefully your partner can let go and move on from that whatever past life that you're referring to. Okay, let's go to comment section. Salam Encik Aiman, apa nak buat bila parents asyik gaduh je dari hal besar sampai sekecil-kecil hal. Even lepas tarawih pun boleh gaduh, masam muka everyday. Oh, susah benda ni. I mean it's not the first time yang saya dapat soalan macam ni. Anak tersepit di tengah-tengah, parents bergaduh. It's tough to answer dengan jawapan yang mudah sebab you kena really imagine macam mana traumatiknya seorang anak untuk menjadi witness, saksi kepada pergaduhan mak ayah dia. Bukan, ia bukan benda yang senang-senang je nak let go tau. Traumatik tau benda ni. And this is something yang saya nak first bagi tahu kepada semua parents di luar sana. Tak kisahlah anak you kecil mana, besar mana pun, jangan fikir yang alah tak apalah anak aku kecil lagi dia akan lupa. No, ataupun tak apalah anak aku dah besar dah, dia orang dah boleh faham benda ni. No. It's always traumatic. Tak kisahlah anak you umur 3 ke 30 untuk tengok mak ayah dia bergaduh. Traumatic. So, be sure kalau you ada masalah dalam perkahwinan you, solve it. You know, or at least get help. Get help. Dapatkan pertolongan untuk nak selesaikan masalah perkahwinan tu. Sebab kalau tak, tengok. Anak yang jadi mangsa di tengah-tengah tu. Dan kepada si anak pula, understand that jawapan saya ni bukannya macam nak menidakkan you punya kesakitan tu. I mean, I cannot imagine lah apa you rasa dalam situasi macam ni. But all I can say, as you know, something that you can use to process this adalah focus on what you can control. Bunyi cliche, but it's true. You cannot control your parents. Their marriage is not your responsibility. Their marriage is their responsibility. Kalau dia orang bergaduh, dia orang kena selesaikan. Bukannya tarik you di tengah-tengah. Kadang-kadang tu saya pernah ada situasi yang mana anak kena jadi referee. Parents minta anak jadi referee. No, no, it's not your role to play. Kalau you ada kebolehan, kemampuan ataupun you nampak ada peluang, ajaklah mak ayah jumpa kaunselor. Jumpa kaunselor perkahwinan ataupun kaunselor keluarga. Sebab kalau benda ni sudah berlarutan begitu lama, ia perlu diselesaikan. Alright. Jangan pula kita delay lama sangat sampai kita berada dalam situasi either perkara ni meletup atau kita kekal dalam kesakitan tu forever. I don't want that for you. So yeah, focus on what you can control. Kalau mak ayah you tak tahu lagi apa you rasa, bagi tahu mak ayah. Mak ayah, every time tengok mak ayah bergaduh, saya rasa macam hati saya kena tarik dua. Right? I mean, mak ayah you kena tahu macam mana you rasa. Sebab mungkin dia orang bergaduh begitu apa khusyuk sangat sampai dia terlupa atau terlepas pandang yang anak dia dengar pergaduhan dia tu. Dan anak dia terkesan dengan pergaduhan dia tu. So kalau mak ayah you tak tahu, bagi tahu. Dan kalau mak ayah you tahu and you ada kemampuan untuk berikan you punya input, bagi tahu kat mak ayah, mak ayah tolong selesaikan dalam sesi counselling. Okay, kami tak tahan dah nak tengok mak ayah bergaduh. It's not nice. Kami tak rasa aman dalam rumah ni. So you have to be honest lah kan. And memanglah dalam sesi honesty tu memang dia orang akan rasa sedih, dia orang akan rasa mungkin sakit hati sebab anak dia cakap macam tu kat dia. Tapi you know, macam saya cakap in the beginning, sometimes it's necessary to hurt feelings because the alternative is much worse. Right? Sometimes this truth have to come out. And susah, memang susah, but it has to come out through conversation, through communication. Otherwise, kalau you simpan benda ni lama-lama, you're not designed to hold this for long. You macam volcano tau. Lama-kelamaan you akan, pressure tu sudah tidak boleh ditahan dan you akan meletup. Okay, and that's what we don't want lah. Meletup tu, meletup yang macam mana? I am horrible at confronting people or debating. I get so frustrated and emotional that I have to walk away. I understand. Memang susah nak berdebate, nak berargue ni. Tapi kita kena faham, it's part of our interaction tau. Memang kita akan ada situasi yang mana kita akan disagree. So kita kena belajar macam mana nak handle. So the good news is this is something you can learn tau. How to manage your emotion. This is something you can learn. That's the good news. The bad news is that it's going to take time. It's going to take a lot of energy, a lot of patience from you to be able to practice and train yourself to be able to manage your emotion properly. My advice, get a mentor. All right? If you know somebody that you think, oh, this person can handle the emotion well, take them as a mentor, see what they do right and learn from them. And try to apply it in your life. Apa nak buat bila parents against career yang kita nak? Saya faham concern mereka tentang duit dan jalan yang saya pilih ambil masa yang lama untuk dapat duit yang cukup. This depends on how well you negotiate with your parents lah. Obviously in the beginning tu you kena tahan sikit lah. Dia orang cakap macam-macam. And I can relate to your question because in the beginning, that was my situation basically. When I started back in 2011, waktu tu study lagi. So waktu tu tak ada masalah lah sebab study lagi kan. And then I decided right after graduation that I want to work as a self-employed individual, which is, you know, orang kata kerja gila apa kan. At least kerja lah bawah orang dulu. But I knew even back then that I am not the kind of person who like the idea of an 8-to-5 job. You know, punch in, punch out, pakai uniform. I'm not that person. And the more I see and hear from people who have 8-to-5 job, the more that I'm convinced that I am not suitable for an 8-to-5 job. Like, kalau you boss saya, you tak suka ada saya sebagai employee because if there's something wrong, I'm going to say stuff, I'm going to voice it out. I'm very vocal. And I mean, kalau ada boss yang suka employee macam saya, ni tak apalah. Right? Tapi kalau ada boss yang jenis yang macam dia nak employee dia sami'na wa ata'na, I'm not that person. I'm not. If there's something wrong, I'm going to say it. So, I realized it's not for me, so I decided to be self-employed lah basically. So what happened is in the beginning, both my parents and my in-laws, both of them, anytime there's a job opportunity, they will tell me, Aiman, tak nak apply ke untuk job ni? Aiman, tak nak apply ke untuk kerja ni? So they will give me like this job offers that, you know, they get from their friends or they get from any WhatsApp group or they get from newspapers. And it kind of, I would be lying lah if I didn't say that. It kind of hurt me a bit because they think that I don't have a job even though I do have a job, you know. Not the kind of job that they think of, but I do have a job. So it did take me some time to build up that financial capability enough so that they stopped asking me to apply for jobs. It took me about, I think at least about 2 years or something like that. 2 years for me to build it up to a point where they no longer ask me to apply for jobs, which is good. And now it's been 10 years I'm doing this job and I love it. I love every single moment of it. But yeah, in the beginning, it's tough. So what I can say is that you have to learn how to manage your emotion. Don't take things too personally, too much, you know. It's not good for you. Plus, it will deter you from actually building that wealth that you want. And secondly, work on your communication skill, right? Learn how to communicate with your parents. My English is considered average, and I need to speak English for most of the time in the office. I stutter a lot and so frustrated when I couldn't deliver my message. Thus, my confidence level drop. What can I say? Go to YouTube and search all the Jackie Chan interviews you can find. That's it. That's all I'm going to say. Search for all Jackie Chan interviews that you can find. What to do dengan colleague yang sangat psycho, tu dia, nak cari salah orang dalam personal office chat room tapi dalam email baik kemain. In professional setting, if you have any issues, use professional methods to solve those issues. That's the general concept. Let me repeat that. In a professional setting, use professional methods to solve professional issues. So this is a professional setting. You ada masalah dengan co-worker you. Gunakan cara professional, right? Invite that particular friend for a short meeting, like a formal meeting, to discuss about his behavior and to discuss how his behavior affect the working space. Or if you have like a formal complaint channel, like an HR department or your boss jenis yang macam very open. So if you want to complain anything, you complain to your boss, go complain to your boss, right? And yeah, maybe some people are not comfortable with that because nanti orang kata macam, you ni kaki complain, you ni boss pet ke apa ke. Which is, by the way, something toxic that we sort of kind of like bring along from our school days. Just forget it, you know? We're professionals, right? If whatever happens at work affects the work productivity, you should address it professionally, full stop. Okay? Tak kisahlah, tapi dia kawan saya, tak kisah. Professional. Personal, cerita lain. Tapi if you cannot like separate professional and personal, that's a problem. You should always be able to separate, this is professional, this is personal. Okay? Yeah, maybe we're friends, and we're still friends, but your behavior at work is really disturbing the work environment. So therefore, I have to address it as a professional. But we're still friends. So that requires a lot of, I think, communication skill from you, of how you manage conflict at workplace. And it really depends on how well you understand the office dynamics. You know, how well do you understand if there's something wrong? Who do you contact? What's the proper channel to address this issue and so on? That depends on how well you know your company lah. Is it normal if you always think that people who surround us hate us because we know how people's feeling based on their action and body language? Actually, you don't know how people feel based on action and body language. That's a false assumption. You could have an idea. Yeah, you can assume. But you can never know, all right? I mean, body language science has been too hyped up where people think that you can figure people out by body language. Actually, the psychological research is clear. It's not like that black and white tau. Dia bukannya macam, oh, I see your body language. Oh, ini yang you sedang fikirkan. No, that's only in TV, all right? So don't think that everything in television you can just apply in real life, okay? So in real life, you cannot truly know what somebody is thinking or feeling unless you communicate with that person. That's the only way you can know. Communication, right? So don't just draw any conclusion just based on observation, especially in a situation where you yourself are overwhelmed with negative emotions, because your observation and your conclusion of that observation is heavily influenced by your emotional state. I'll give you an example. If I'm angry, I'm really angry, right? If I'm really angry and I see something neutral, there's a higher tendency that I'm going to interpret that neutral thing as something hostile because of my emotional state. So be very careful about how you interpret things, because your emotional state is highly, highly, highly influential in how you make certain conclusions. Your best bet is to drop all assumptions and actually communicate with people. You know, communicate. That's how you know. How to handle the fear of rejection? You can read this book that I recommend earlier. Let me just show you this book, Emotional First Aid by Dr. Guy Winch. All right? It's a good book. Highly recommended. Next question. Salam, I was hired. Congratulations. However, my parents don't seem to like my job because not my field, but my husband is okay with it. I am sad that they don't support me. Am I being derhaka? Well, you have to understand what derhaka means. Derhaka doesn't mean that you disagree with your parents. That's not what derhaka means. And you can refer to the Quran about this. The Quran says, do good to your parents. Have ihsan with your parents. That's what the Quran says. So really, your responsibility to your parents is not to obey everything they say. That's not the responsibility of a child. The responsibility of a child is to treat their parents with the highest level of akhlaq that you can. So it's about treatment. It's about how you treat your parents. It's not about whether you disagree with your parents or agree with your parents. No. If you continue to treat your parents with the highest level of reverence, highest level of akhlaq, you're not derhaka, even though they don't like it. Their response is not the indication of derhaka or not derhaka. Understand? Their response is not the indication of derhaka or not derhaka. Oh, kalau macam tu, para sahabat ramai derhaka. Sebab when they enter Islam, many of their parents did not. And many of their parents hate them for it. So, dia orang derhaka ke? No. Because they continue to treat their parents, even though their parents don't like it, they continue to treat their parents with ihsan. So they are not derhaka. They keep on their responsibility as a child. But whether the parents suka diorang ke, tak suka diorang ke, that's not the indication of derhaka. Understand? Your parents' feelings towards you or your parents' reaction towards you, that's not the indication of you are derhaka ke, you're not derhaka. Okay? The indication is how do you treat your parents? That's the indication. Next question. Ada tak rujukan free access untuk ujian psychometric? Ada, tapi saya tak recommend lah yang free-free ni. Sebab, you know, bila free ni, obviously, it's questionable lah whether you dapat benda yang high quality ataupun tidak. Saya lebih recommend kalau you nak ujian psychometric, you terus dapatkan daripada seorang counselor. Okay? Itu saya recommend lah. Dan kalau you mampu, you beli ujian tu daripada publisher yang well established supaya you dapat benda yang betul-betul high quality. Alright? So, okay dah 50 minit dah. Dah pukul 2 petang dah, saya nak kena solat Zuhur pula. Thank you very much everybody for joining me, and be aware yang Jumaat ni, website di sini, imazan.com/kahwin. Jumaat ni saya akan sambung webinar ketiga dalam siri Kahwin 2.0. Webinar ketiga ni tentang menjadi redha. Macam mana kita nak menjadi redha bila situasi tu tidak seperti apa yang kita mahukan, impikan. Alright? So kita akan belajar pasal istikharah, in and out, supaya kita faham dan kita boleh mulakan proses nak move on. Jumaat ni, 9:30 malam. Make sure you pergi di imazan.com/kahwin. Semua information ada kat sini. Semua information dekat sini. Alright? Itu sahaja daripada saya. See you guys tomorrow for the next chill session. Assalamualaikum. Take care. Selamat berpuasa. Selamat berbuka. Bye.